Today I'm going to be discussing discharging capacitors. And if you're here because you're interested in this topic, then you probably already know why capacitors need to be discharged before working on equipment. Therefore, I won't go into that. But I will say that there are many capacitors, especially in tube equipment and televisions and other types of equipment, that hold quite a lot of charge. Large capacitors, such as this one right here, this large electrolytic, and ones in capacitors that are subject to a high voltage, can store a large charge for a long period of time. And even after equipment is unplugged, don't count on the fact that that capacitor is going to discharge by itself or through the circuitry that it's connected to. It may not. So there's no use in taking any chances. They need to be discharged. Now, I've seen many videos on YouTube, just sort of happened upon them, which are always kind of a joke, where people discharge or claim that their technique for discharging capacitors is to take some kind of a metal device, screwdriver, and short the leads out. And even in some videos, I see people having fun making sparks doing that. Even sticking metallic objects in the circuit itself and trying to short things out. And I've seen other videos where people are attaching light bulbs between the leads of capacitors. And those are all completely incorrect from a safety standpoint. And the safest way to discharge a capacitor is, first of all, using a resistor. And I'm going to draw a diagram of that in a minute. And second of all, using a resistor that's attached to a probe so that when you are discharging capacitors that are part of a circuit, that you can do it with one hand. The other hand should be in a pocket or behind your back, and the part that you're touching is insulated. And so in essence, the best way to do it is with a probe, and I've made my own. Probe is attached to a wire, and on the other end is an alligator clip or some kind of a clip, because you don't want to have two hands in your circuit at the same time, because you don't want to complete a circuit and you don't want yourself becoming a resistor, because when that happens and you touch, you complete a circuit across a 900 volt capacitor, 400 volt, 500 volt, then you're going to get one heck of a shock, and it's potentially deadly. Therefore, discharging a capacitor should be done with one hand, with your hand far enough away so there's no chance that you're going to be touching two places at once in the circuit. And again, the way to do that is a probe with a wire, an inline resistor, and an alligator clip. Okay. Now, let me... Alright, this is my device. It's homemade. I like making things myself out of raw materials that I have on hand. And so I'm going to first show you on paper how it's made and the parts you'll need. Now, I've already made this, so I'm not going to be building one in this video, but I'm going to show you how to make one. And the key to this whole thing is the resistance, the inline resistance that you're going to need. So let me begin with just drawing a diagram. Okay, so first we're going to begin with a wire. I recommend a heavier gauge wire, like something like a 16 gauge, not that little thin stuff, a 20, 22 plus gauge, so something like a 16. I happen to be using some speaker wire right here, just leftover wire that I had. So we start with the wire, and for the probe end, which is the piece you're going to be touching to circuitry, capacitor leads to discharge it. You can use anything metallic. I've used a nail. It's a finishing nail. And for the probe end, I am going to solder the wire to the finishing nail, like that. And to stiffen it up, because you want something kind of stiff when you touch things, it doesn't bend, use something that is non-conductive, such as wood. I'm using a skewer. You can use a chopstick. And so I place the piece of wood, the skewer, the chopstick here, and then I cover up the whole thing with electrical tape. I wrapped it about four or five times with electrical tape. Again, the wire soldered to the nail, covered up with tape. And that's the probe end, like that. Now the other end is the end with the alligator clip. I'm just going to draw the alligator clip kind of like that. Now, between the alligator clip and the wire, you've got to have a resistor. And you can't see it here, but it's in there. So, you solder the resistor, one end to the alligator clip, the other end to the wire, and again, wrap it all up in electrical tape or shrink wrap if you want. Something that's well insulated. And that's this end. So that's pretty much it. Now the key here is choosing the correct resistor. Now, first of all, because I kind of like to get into things and explain why things are done, I'm going to divert just for a second, and in my discussion of choosing the right resistor, and I'll tell you what, I'm going to tell you right now, in case you wanted to build one of these things, you're not interested in why, I'll tell you I use a 470 ohm 5 watt resistor. And I noticed that there are other folks around that use that value as well. I'm using that value because that's how I was taught by a college instructor years ago, and I never questioned it. I never questioned where the value came from. And I trust in him, and sure enough, it works. And other people use that value, and it's perfectly fine. But I do want to tell you where that value comes from, why it's a good value. As opposed to, I've seen other videos where people are using 10 ohm resistors, and I saw at least, I've come across at least one, not a video, but some advice online about using a 10K resistor, which is ridiculous. So 475 watts. If you wanted to build one, that's it right there. Alligator clip, solder the resistor, other end of the wire, solder a probe on the end like a nail, stiffen it up with something that's non-conductive, and you can see right here, piece sticking out is the skewer, it's a wooden skewer, just to stiffen it up, wrap the whole thing in electrical tape or shrink wrap, and you're good to go. And you're ready to discharge capacitors. And just real quick, before I get into where that 470 ohm resistor comes from, I might be the only one in the world that finds that fascinating, but I will go ahead and just give you a quick demonstration of how to discharge a capacitor with this device. Now, there are a lot of things to factor in with respect to electrical safety that I won't get into here, I'm just going to be discussing discharging capacitors. However, when you have a circuit exposed, especially a high voltage circuit, such as this is a tube amplifier, where we have voltages up to, in this case, 400, but you can have voltages up to 900 in certain tube amplifiers. You always, especially when the thing is on, you're probing around with one hand. The other hand is behind your back or in your pocket. You never want to use two hands because you could potentially complete a circuit and then you'll become the resistor and it's going to hurt. But once we get this thing discharged, this is unplugged, off, and once we get the capacitors discharged, it's pretty safe to start working on it at that point. So, with the one-handed technique, we can't be just probing around like that with two, trying to complete a circuit. We want to use the alligator clip to attach to a ground point, and so that when we probe around with the probe, we'll be completing a circuit through the resistor to ground to discharge the capacitor. So you find a ground point, and I won't get into how to find that, but for me, on this circuit, I'm going to attach it to the power receptacle on the third prong. It's earth grounded, and I can actually see it from here. It's attached to the chassis. I'm not going to attach it directly to the chassis because this chassis has been powder coated, and that increases the resistance. I want a good connection to ground. Okay, now with that attached, and with one hand, I can start just touching capacitor leads. I don't have the time to figure out which one's positive and negative. I'm just going to touch both. There's a couple capacitor there, there's one there. And I'm going to hold the probe there for about a second or two on each lead. And that's the idea. One hand only. And if there are any charges on those capacitors, they will be, in less than a second, discharged using this device. Never stick a screwdriver in there and try to short leads out. You don't do that because that can destroy a capacitor, especially an oil, paper cap, or an electrolytic. By shorting out the capacitor, you're effectively asking the capacitor to, at least for a very brief period of time, supply a virtually infinite amount of current. It's a dead short. And the internal components of these capacitors can't handle that. And you could damage the capacitor, you could partially damage it. You don't want that. You want to do it right. Okay. So, if you wanted to build one, I've given you enough information to do so. If you're interested in where that 470 ohm value comes from, so that you know, if you're given advice to use some other value, you can kind of figure out if that value is going to work or not, I'm going to show you how to do it. Or maybe someone's been telling you to use a lower or higher value and you've been using it. In essence, you shouldn't be seeing a spark when you're discharging your capacitor using this method. If you're seeing a spark, even with a resistive probe like this, your resistance is too low. And if it takes more than a couple of seconds to discharge a capacitor, then your resistance is too high. This 470 ohms is an optimal value. It doesn't have to be 470, it could be a slightly higher. You know, 600 something, could be 300 something, but within that range. So let's get to the theory of this. And to begin with, so you don't have to watch me draw, I've gone ahead and drawn this out. This is a symbol for a capacitor. In this case, I've selected a very common value for power supplies. It is a 200 microfarad 400-volt capacitor. The 470 ohm will work for a wide range of values within standard values that are used in power supplies. But just for the sake of this example, we're going to be using this capacitor. In this circuit, I have a switch, just for the sake of explanation, and then here's our resistor. Now, it doesn't matter for this purpose right here what the resistor is, but ultimately it will be our 470 ohm. So, first thing, what happens when a capacitor is fully charged and I close the switch, completing the circuit through the resistor? Well, the capacitor is going to discharge. It's going to discharge at a certain rate. Now, of course, if it was a dead short here, it would be almost instantaneous and the current would be virtually infinite. The current would only be limited by the internal resistance of the wires. That's not good. So this resistor serves to reduce the current and slow down the rate of discharge. What we're looking at here is a graph of, on this axis we have time in seconds, and on this axis we have voltage. So given our scenario here, we have 400 volts as our starting point. When we close the switch, current will flow through the resistor and discharge fast at first, and then it's going to slow down, and reach a certain almost steady state point. Never fully discharges to zero, but we don't care about that. We just want to get it very, very low. The period of time we're looking for here or the period of time to fully discharge this capacitor is a simple equation. It's 5, that's a 5, not an S, multiplied by the resistance, multiplied by the capacitance. And it doesn't matter what the starting voltage is. It will be completely discharged, at least well over 90% discharged to where it's safe. If you multiply 5 by the resistance value by the capacitance value. Resistance is in ohms, capacitance is in farads. Now, knowing that, and if we were just to sort of start out and just randomly pick resistive values, saying, oh, any old resistance will do, we could be way off. That's not true. So what I've done is we are going to explore different values of resistance just to show why 470 is a good value. So here's our circuit, same one as before. We're going to be using 200 microfarads and as our capacitor with 400 volts on it. And our value of R, we're going to randomly pick a few. Hopefully we get lucky, right? Well, we're going to start out with 1 mega ohms for the resistor. Then we're going to move down to 1 ohm and see what happens. And then we're going to look at our 470. So let's start out with 1 mega ohms. What if we randomly pick 1 meg as our resistor? I'm going to run some numbers here and show you why that's not good. It's way too high. So, if we pick 1 meg as our resistor, and let me draw a switch here. Okay. Zoom in. So 1 meg is our resistor, and we were to close the switch, what would happen? Well, remember, 5 multiplied by resistance in ohms multiplied by capacitance in farads is going to tell us the point in time in seconds when that capacitor is going to be fully discharged, at least to the point where it's very safe. That's going to take 16 minutes with a 1 mega ohm resistor. And that's too long. That's just wait. It's just not necessary to wait 16 minutes to discharge a capacitor, regardless of the size of the capacitor. On the other hand, the peak current that's going to flow, right as you turn the switch on, the highest current flow is going to happen right at the beginning, and the current's slowly going to slow down get much lower. But the instantaneous peak current when you hit that switch will only be 0.0004 amperes, 400 microamperes. Very, very low current. That's a good thing. But the 16 minutes is a bad thing. So what if we go to the opposite extreme? And we decide, okay, well, that's 16 minutes is way too long, so let's choose 1 ohm. Well, that's a pretty low value for resistance, 1 ohm. So let's run the numbers again. Well, 5 times 1 ohm times 200 microfarads, or 0.0002 farads, will yield 100 microseconds, meaning, you know, a small fraction of a second, and that capacitor is going to be discharged. Well, you might say, well, that's a good thing. It's over with. Well, it's not necessarily a good thing, because, again, that instantaneous current that's going to be drawn will be 400 amps. So with that 1 ohm resistor, when we first close the switch, or when we first touch the probe to the capacitor, right there at the beginning, when the current's going to be highest, before the voltage starts to go down, we're going to have 400 amperes. That's too high. That could fry a resistor. It could potentially damage the capacitor. The small leads of these resistors don't want to see 400 amperes. So this resistance value is clearly too low. I'll tell you that 10 ohms is too low as well. It's just not worth risking it. So let's come across. Let's go down to our 470 that I've already established as being decent, and look at the same numbers. So if we're using our 470 ohm resistor, that capacitor will be discharged, in, or at least the sample 200 microfarad capacitor will be discharged in 0.2 of a second. That's great. That's a reasonable amount of time. Only have to hold a probe on there for about a second to be safe, maybe 2 seconds. But the thing will be discharged in 0.2 of a second. And at the same time, our peak instantaneous current will only be less than 1 amp, in this case 0.85 amps. And the wires, the wire you're using for your probe and the wires that go into the resistors, they can handle that just fine. So this 470 is a good compromise between, between the amount of time to discharge and the peak current. And 0.85 amperes is certainly not unreasonable to ask of a capacitor as you're discharging it. 400 is unreasonable. And again, our 1 meg 16 minutes is unreasonable to discharge a capacitor. So, what I decided to do, and this is kind of sloppy, but I decided, okay, well, you know, I was using our 200 microfarad capacitor with 400 volts, but let me give you a scenario where the capacitance is much higher and the voltage is much higher, which will take longer to discharge and cause a higher instantaneous current to flow. So down here I chose a 1000 microfarad capacitor. That's huge, with 900 volts across it. Ran the numbers again, we have 2.35 seconds to discharge down to almost nothing, and a peak current of 2.12 amperes. Again, both very reasonable. It's a good compromise between the two. And of course, for lower values of capacitance, which most power supply caps are lower than even this one, it's going to be quicker to discharge. Lower voltages, less amperage, instantaneous amperage. Now, mentioned earlier that when you discharge a capacitor, the voltage is going to follow a curve like this. The voltage will start dropping rapidly, then sort of level off right there. So what does this mean with respect to the power of the resistor that you're going to buy? You can buy different power resistors, quarter watt, eighth watt, quarter watt, half watt, 1 watt. Well, when you buy a resistor, for example, that's rated at 1 watt, that really means that that resistor can handle continuously for long periods of time dissipating 1 watt. In our case, we're not going to be asking the resistor to dissipate power for a very long period of time. We'll be asking it to dissipate power in this example for only about 0.2 seconds, and it won't even be full power. It'll be the most power it's going to dissipate will be a very short period of time right here, and it's going to get lower and lower and lower. Power being V squared divided by R. So a 1 watt resistor could handle all of this, but I would recommend getting something along the lines of a 5 watt. You don't need one of those huge 100 watt power resistors. It won't hurt, but you don't want to, if you attach one of those big 100 watt guys to this probe, the probe's going to be kind of clunky. So I'm using 5 watts, and I've never had a problem with it. So there you have it. I always like to give a little bit of a reasoning behind why things are done, a little bit of background. Probably completely unnecessary, but I find it interesting. And I was making this probe the other day because my other one just got a little too old, and I thought, well, maybe it would be helpful to make a video, but I didn't while I was making it, but I figured I'd make it after the fact. So there we go. I hope this helps. Appreciate it. Thanks for watching. And good night. Alright, this is an addendum to my video, because as I went back and watched it, a couple of things occurred to me that I just want to clarify, and then one thing occurred to me that I never thought about before, and regarding the design of a capacitance discharge probe. So let me just quickly cover those things. I was mentioning in the video showing how to probe, using your one hand, and our alligator clip is attached somewhere to a ground point. And I just wanted to make sure, I didn't mean to imply that the tip of this probe, which is conductive, and this happens to be a nail, we have to be careful that we touch to one lead of the capacitor at a time. Hold it there for a second or two, one lead at a time. We have to be careful not to, when you have these axial leaded capacitors where the two leads come out of the same end, we just don't stick this thing down there and try to touch both leads together, because then that defeats the entire purpose of this probe. So just be careful to touch one lead at a time as we're discharging. Now technically we'd only need to touch the positive side, because the negative side will not be will be at ground potential. There are times in circuits that you, in this capacitor here, the indication of positive and negative is kind of hidden, and I don't want to be moving this thing around, so I'm just going to, it's okay to touch each of them individually, hold it for a couple seconds, and then get down there and touch the other one while being careful not to short the two together. So, that's the first thing I wanted to say. Now, the second thing is something that occurred to me that I guess never occurred to me before about the design of the probe. Here is the diagram I had drawn earlier where I show the nail being soldered to a wire covered in tape or shrink wrap. And on the other end we had our alligator clip with our resistor soldered to the alligator clip on one side and the resistor soldered to the wire on the other, covered in electrical tape or shrink wrap. And it kind of occurred to me, now I've been using this design for years, but for some reason it just occurred to me, I think I would, if I ever build another one, I'm gonna flip things around a little bit, and I'll tell you why. I think this is a better design right here. Okay, there's our nail, and I think it would be better to go ahead and solder our resistor to the nail, then to the wire, and then directly to the alligator clip. And for two reasons, this is a better design. Number one, we only have to shrink wrap one portion right here. I would always go ahead and shrink wrap the end of the alligator clip or wire tape it, just because I don't like to see connections, but that wouldn't be necessary with this design. And the second reason why this is actually better is because you have, once you touch the high voltage source, the current will travel through the nail and directly through the resistor right at the front end, so that the wire itself, the entire length of the wire, including down to the alligator clip, will always remain at ground potential. And that's probably safer and probably better. Now, I've been doing it this way for 25, 30 years, and I've never had an issue. Well, it just occurred to me, I think I would recommend doing it that way. So again, our probe, metal probe, in this case a nail, soldered to the resistor, the other end of the resistor soldered to the wire, which goes to the alligator clip. I think that's better, and I would recommend that. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention for anyone who's going to watch this video and attempt to build one of these things. And I think that's, let's see. Oh yeah, and the other thing I wanted to say, and this is not really necessary, but also didn't mean to imply, if I did, that every single capacitor on a circuit board needs to be discharged. You've got to know which ones. You don't need to run through, you know, if you have a large circuit board with tons of tiny mica or ceramic disc capacitors, little tiny guys that don't really store any significant charge, they don't need to be discharged. It's the big ones. It's the power supply caps, mostly. And you got to know which ones to, and you know, with experience, you kind of know, but you got to know which ones to discharge. But certainly if you have hundreds of these little things on a large circuit board, you don't need to keep probing around and touching all of them. That's just not necessary. It's a waste of time. Little tiny ones, not a problem. It's, you're going to know by looking in there. When you see the, pretty much any cap that's, you know, larger than my thumb in diameter, you know, I'm going to try to discharge. And that's a rule of thumb. But, you know, again, the tiny little guys, you don't need to worry about those. Little mica and little ceramic disc capacitors, they store nothing, relatively speaking. So, thanks for watching. Cheers.